Today, Adobe dropped an update to Lightroom Classic, and there's some great new features. Let's have a look at them right now. First feature we're going to look at is generative AI right inside of Lightroom. It can be used to remove objects. So if we go to the develop module, and then we go down to where you see the eraser tool, you'll see there's a remove. And we have the traditional tools, but if we turn on generative AI on this tool here, on the remove tool, this is going to do a generative remove. We also have object aware. And we'll look at this. Okay, so let's make a selection. Now, I'm not going to release yet. Let's make a selection around this light stand. And looks like it missed a little bit there. Now I'm going to release, and the object aware is going to kind of kick in. And notice we have the ability to add or subtract from here, so we can refine this mask. So I'm going to add on here. I'm going to make sure I get the bottom part of there, and looks like there's a little bit there too. So when you're ready to apply, simply click apply. And now generative remove is going to be using generative AI here. And look at that. It removes everything in the background. Now, if you've used generative fill in Photoshop, you'll know there's variations. And we can see, yes, we have three variations here. And that one was funny. That looks like that's the best variation. Okay, so here's a question. How well does this actually work? Let's find out. Let's see if we can get rid of Brooke. I want to use a larger brush, so we're going to use the right bracket key. And let's paint over our entire model. And I'm going to release. And it's all selected. And now we're going to hit apply. So in this place, it actually got rid of the person. I think that's pretty impressive. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications. You won't miss any of my videos. So this new feature, I never thought it was actually going to happen, because that would require Sony to be sharing the API with Adobe. But guess what? It happened. Now we have tethered shooting for Sony cameras. I have the Sony A1, so we're going to be using this. First of all, we've got to change some menu settings here. Let's go down to network, smartphone connect, choose smartphone connection, and we want to turn that off. Now we want to go to transfer remote, then we want to go to PC remote function, go down to the connect method, and make sure it's set to USB. Now go up to the PC remote, turn it to on, and once you've got all the settings, plug it in that USB-C cable, connect it to your computer, and now you're ready for tethered shooting. So if we choose File, Tethered Capture, and choose Start Tethered Capture, so what you want to do is give the session a name, and then set a location where you want it to go. And then we're going to click OK. And look at that. I've got my Sony A1 plugged in right now. And it just detected it so quick. The tethering in here actually works faster than it does in the Canon and the Nikon one right now. You'll notice here we can see the camera. And also the interface is a little slicker than it used to be. So let's have a look at this. I'm just going to move it up the top. If I choose live, look at this. We can now... Literally, here's my monitor set up, by the way. We can literally look at this live. And if I take the shot, it's going to load it into Lightroom. Let me just shrink this down a little bit. Move it off to the side, see how we can do that. Or we can even go in portrait mode if we want. And there's the shot that's been taken in. Now, here's something I want to show you is how fast this works. That's a shot. That's a shot, that's a shot, that's a shot, that's a shot. All right, so this is a 50 megapixel camera, and as you can see, these are loading in super, super fast. I'm really excited about that. One of the other things that we can do too is we can apply some different settings. So if we want, we can apply any of these presets as we shoot them. We can change the white balance on the camera. We can change the ISO, so if we want to go to manual ISO, and you can see in the corner there what the camera's seeing. We can change that. And we can also change things like the aperture. And stop it down a little bit. Let's slow down the shutter speed. Oh, by the way, let's put this the right way up. There we go. And if we want, we can also remote shoot, so we could have the camera on a tripod and then just click this button here. And that will take a shot whenever we push that shutter button. Now, here's another interesting thing. We can change the focus. Okay, I just changed the lens and I'm going to turn the camera back on. And notice how it redetected the camera as soon as I turned the camera back on. I didn't have to restart the tethering like I would have in the past. I'm going to put the camera into manual focus. And now that the camera's in manual focus mode, you'll see that we can change the focus. So this is all happening through the software. And as we get less arrows, then we get more of a fine focus. So we can go in and just kind of refine that focus, or we can switch back to autofocus again. The next new feature we want to look at is lens blur. Now, lens blur was introduced last year as a preview. And now if we look at it, it's now out of beta. So to apply it, we just simply choose apply. And what it's going to do is it's going to analyze, it's going to find the foreground, which will be the helicopter, and then it's going to blur the background. So if we change the blur amount, we can see how we can blur that background. Now I'm going to increase the blur all the way. And if you look at this focus range, if I pull it towards me, notice what it does is it brings this foreground area into focus. If we drag it away, it brings the background area into focus. See that? But what we want to do is narrow the depth of field. So if we pull this in here, we can choose a narrower area that's going to be in focus. Now it's going to be more realistic. See, as I'm pulling it forward, now the helicopter's nice and sharp. And then it comes even more forward and we get the foreground area. Now it looks like there's some problems up here in the rotor blade. So let's have a look at this. We're going to choose visualize depth. Visualize depth shows us where things are. So the darker they are, the further away they are, the lighter they are, the closer they are to us. So one of the problems I see already, apart from the rotor blades here, is the ground underneath the helicopter should be the same shade as the helicopter. That means it's going to be on the same focal plane. So if it's further away, when we've got this set to blurry, that means it's going to blur. If it's closer to us, then it's going to focus. So if we look at this as too dark, means it's too far away, means we want to bring it forward. So that means we want to add a little bit of focus here. So we've got that amount there. And then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to paint on here. And you can see as I'm painting it, it's bringing it forward more. Now it looks like the auto mask is on. Let's turn that auto mask off and that will just enable us just to paint freely. And if I look at this, see how that yellow is a little brighter than the helicopter and even the ground here, which means that this would be forward. This would be further back. Now this is more forward than further back again. We want that shade to be the same and we can change it by going in here and adjusting the amount. And by adjusting the amount now, we can get a very realistic fall off. See how now it's the same shade here? So this is really the secret sauce, using visualized depth, matching the color tones, and then we can get it the same focal plane. So if we turn off this, and now we change the focal plane, look at this. Now the helicopter's in focus, and so is the ground underneath it. All right, let's fix the rotor blades. Obviously, the blur has turned up too much. We'll fix that later, but let's turn on visualize depth. We want to go in closer. Let's click up here at 100%. Grab the spacebar, and we can move this around. Yeah, so look at that. That's definitely the wrong shade. We need that to be different. Let's just zoom out a little bit because it's kind of hard to see it. There we go. That's better. And I'm going to turn on auto mask. And I'm going to hit the left bracket key to make the brush just a little bit bigger than the rotor blade. So that means if it's too dark, that means it's too far away. That means we want to make it sharper. So we're going to be using focus. So let's paint with the focus. Look at this. We can easily select it. I went a bit over there. No problem. If we go over, we can fix that. But let's just make sure we select the whole thing first. Nice. And let's just make sure it's properly selected. Great. Let's use the Alt key or the Option key. And let's make that little smaller using the left bracket key, and now we can just kind of clean up these areas where we went over. So the Alt or the Option will switch this from adding to subtracting. Let's do the same here. Sometimes it's easier for these kind of shapes to kind of overpaint them and then just come back and clean them up later, like we're doing right now. Great. Okay, now let's have a look at the amount. Let's make it a little brighter. I'm going to say about there. It's starting to look quite similar to the rest of the helicopter. Great. Let's grab the space bar. And I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. Okay. And let's change the amount. A little bit darker. There we go. Now, if we look at this and we turn off the visualized depth, the rotor blades should be much more accurate once we get to the focus of the helicopter. Let's grab this little tool here and just click. This is our focus tool, and we're going to click right there. So this area is in focus. Look at that. The rotor blades are now in focus. The ground is in focus. Great. Now, what we would do is maybe extend this depth of field a little bit so we can see a little bit further, make it a little bit more realistic, bring it a little bit towards the front. Now, the blur is very substantial. Maybe we might want to bring that blur back a little bit to something more realistic. Now, the blur algorithm has also been updated to make it look more realistic. So one of the things we can do here is we can change the bokeh, and this will change how the background blurs. And it will simulate different apertures on different types of cameras. And another thing you'll notice is the lens blur. See how it got in these little gaps? It did a lot better job than it used to with these fine areas. So it's definitely a big improvement than what it was. Now, another thing about the lens blur that's kind of interesting is it can now be added to presets. So we can actually have the image automatically detect the subject and blur the background, and we can build that into our presets now. The other thing we can do too is we can copy and paste it between different images. So say right now I wanted to copy, we'll choose develop settings and copy settings. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to check none, and let's just do the lens blur and focus on subject. So we're going to copy that. And let's grab another subject, such as this taxi cab. And now we're going to right click and paste the settings. Develop settings, paste settings. Now it's going to be applying those same settings. Look at that. It applies the same settings that we did on the helicopter. And now it's blurring the background in this photo of the cab in New York City. Now if we look at this before and after, it's got us most of the way there. That doesn't mean that we can't go in and make adjustments, because through that window there, we definitely need to do that. So we're going to add a little bit of blur. Make sure auto mask is turned on, and then just go in this area here. And we can just kind of blur that background. And if you want, you can adjust the amount of that. I think about there looks pretty good. Thanks for watching. I'm curious, what is your favorite new feature? Let me know in the comments underneath. And if you're new, welcome to the cafe. So you don't miss any of my tutorials, hit that subscribe button, turn on notification, and you won't miss my next upload. So anyway, guys, until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.